This is a lecture from Open Tuition. To benefit from the lecture, you should download the free lecture notes from opentuition.com.
This is the last of the discussion chapters, the chapters without calculations, and it's behavioural finance. This has become quite important because it's something the examiner brought into the syllabus relatively recently. Certainly, I mean, it has been asked, it could be asked again, never as an entire question, but certainly it could be one written part of a question to do with something else. And what it relates to is this. Both companies, obviously, and investors are making financial decisions. Companies are deciding, for example, whether they should invest in a new project or not. Investors are making decisions, should they buy shares in this company or not? And in the exam, when we come to the numbers, we assume they are making sensible, rational decisions. You know, we're going to check on net present value calculations in a later chapter, but you should all have seen basic net present value calculations in earlier exams. And you know that we forecast what all the cash flows are going to be. We discount, we get the net present value, and we say, if it's positive, we'll accept. If it's negative, we reject. You know, there are rules. We're making a rational decision. Or if we're choosing between two investments, take the one with the highest net present value. Fine. And we assume, that's what we always do in the exam. We assume that companies and investors are making rational decisions, but in fact, they very often make decisions for other reasons. They very often don't make rational decisions, and what behavioural finance is about is simply trying to decide why it is that they don't always make rational decisions. That's all. And we say, you'll see there, assumptions for rational decisions. We make three assumptions, but then we're going to look at why these assumptions might not hold true for both investors and for companies in real life. And the three assumptions we make when we calculate an NPV and accept if it's positive and so on, we assume that the decision makers want to maximise their utility. Now here I'm using the examiner's words, but what all it means is that investors want to maximise the value of their shares, companies want to maximise the value of the company, or the directors want to maximise the value of the company. That's what we mean by maximise utility. We said way back in, I think it was the first lecture, that the objective is to maximise shareholders' wealth, to maximise the share price, to maximise the value. Well, we assume that that's always the case. That is what we want to achieve. Secondly, we assume that whether it's an investor thinking of buying shares or whether it's the company deciding whether to invest in the project, we assume we look at all relevant information. Seems sensible? That's what we do in numbers questions in this exam. That they've looked at all the relevant information in making the decision. And finally, we assume that if they're making decisions rationally, that they undertake rational objective, the people making the decision, that they are rational, that they're objective, they're risk neutral. Rational, that they're sensible, they're objective. You know, it's not based on just their feelings, they're actually looking at the numbers, that's good, that's bad, you know. And that they're risk neutral. that they're not deliberately avoiding an investment purely because it's risky or something, but got a neutral attitude. Now, that's what's needed to make rational decisions, and yet again, that's the effectively the way we behave when we're making decisions in the exam. But as I said, in real life, people do make perhaps what you might call odd decisions because those three assumptions may not hold true. And so for the exam, you need to be aware of the three assumptions, be clear what they mean, but also, depending on what the question asks, look at those three assumptions in real life, both from the investor's point of view, if you're deciding on whether to buy shares, or alternatively, again, depending on the question, from the company's point of view, if the company's deciding on a new project or whether to buy another company and so on. So let's look first of all from the investor's point of view. Oops, which I can't spell. Someone who's thinking of buying shares. First of all, we assume their objective is always to maximise their utility. As I said earlier, that means their assumption is to maximise the share price, their wealth. They choose to invest in wherever's going to increase their wealth the most. However, they don't always do that in real life. Other factors come into play. I've given an example then. In my note on the next page, some people, for ethical reasons, don't want to invest in cigarette companies or might not want to invest in alcohol companies. That's fine, but they're not looking then purely at which would increase their wealth the most. Maybe cigarette companies would increase their wealth enormously, but they're ignoring that. Another factor's come into play, the ethical side of it. Another quite common example is that suppose you've bought shares, you've already got shares, so the decision you're making is whether to keep them or whether to sell them. And suppose the share price has been falling, and realistically, it's probably going to carry on falling. Well, if you want to maximise your wealth, it'd be better to get rid of them, sell them before they fall anymore. But there's a sort of psychological side to it, that the share price has been falling, but you think, oh, this can't go on forever, you know. By the law of averages, it's bound to start going up at some stage. And so you refuse to sell, even though rationally you should, the price will probably carry on falling. You refuse to sell, because you have this sort of belief, for no real reason, that it can't carry on falling, it's bound to go up sometime. So you hold on to shares. I'm not going to write down the whole note, but you hold on to shares even though, rationally, you're being silly. You should get rid of them now. Look at all relevant information. You know, if you're deciding to whether to buy shares in a company or not, you should look at all the information available. What are the future prospects and so on? But people, other factors, again, come into play. Again, something else that's very common is you're wondering whether to buy some shares. You see, ooh. Everybody's buying shares in Company X. They must know something I don't. I'll buy shares in Company X as well. It's called the herd instinct. Herd. Oh dear. You know, we talk about a group of cows being a herd of cows, or a group of sheep being a herd of sheep, and they tend to follow each other. Well, buying shares just because everybody else is buying them. You know, maybe there is something good about the company, but rather than look at all the information and make the decision ourselves, we're being irrational. We're just following what other people are doing. Finally, you should be rational, objective, risk neutral. Again, it's not always the case. As I've written, People tend to attach more importance to information that confirms what they already believe. You know, maybe you've got shares in a company, you're deciding whether to keep them or sell them. And you believe that it's a strong company. You have this belief. They make computers, and you've got this belief. They've always done well. I believe this is a good computer company. They make the best computers. It's good. I'm going to stay. You look at the accounts, and in fact, the financial statements don't look very good at all. All right, the revenue's increasing because they've been putting prices up a lot, but the profits are dropping. Well, you don't like to believe that what you think is wrong. You concentrate and you say, well, the revenue's going up. That confirms what I thought. This is a good company. And you're sort of partly ignoring the fact that profits are falling. You look at the bits that confirm what you already thought. I can't really think of a way of writing that briefly, but you're not being rational. You're not looking at all the information that making a rational decision on it. Okay, that's as regards investors. In a very similar way, though, what about companies making decisions? The directors of a company. And so the financial managers again, in calculations in the exam, when we're doing things like net present value calculations, we assume that those three statements hold true. But similar to investors, in real life, they may not. First of all, maximisation of utility. Well, I'll use the example that I've actually written in the notes. Their object should be to maximise the value of the company. That should be all they're really concerned about. But suppose they're thinking of taking over another company. If they're thinking of buying another company, they should look at the information, decide what a fair value is, and that's the most they should be prepared to pay. So maybe you offered $1 million for another company, and that's a fair price. But what often happens is that perhaps somebody else then puts in a bid and offers $1.1 million. Well, if you thought $1 million was a fair price, you should pull out. But there is this temptation. You know, you've got excited about buying the company. Oh, they've offered 1.1, right, we'll offer 1.2 million. And you end up overpaying. You're not maximising the value of the company. So there's just one example. Overpaying for an acquisition. But appreciate, you know, if you're writing this in the exam, appreciate why that can happen. It's a behavioural thing. You end up doing it without really intending to because other people have offered more. We want that company, so let's keep offering even though we're being silly. Next one. Again, we should look at all the relevant information. That seems sensible, and I keep saying in arithmetic questions in the exam, we do all the information in the question. But in practice, it may not always be the case. People make assumptions with no true basis. Again, looking at the example of buying another company, and something we'll again discuss more about later, but one potential benefit in buying another company is synergy. That we'll be able to make savings by, you know, merge the two companies together. We won't need as many staff, perhaps, because there's duplication. Another thing that we often do, we say, oh, this other company, we could manage it a lot better. And therefore, if we take over the other company, we can make more profits than they're currently making. Well, we assume that without necessarily having all the relevant information necessary, which is just an assumption. For example, we assume we can manage better. And therefore, the other company will make more profits once we've taken it over. But is that really true? Have we really investigated it? And the answer is probably no. We've just assumed that's going to be the case and tried to put a figure to it. Finally, rational objective risk neutral. Exactly the same, really, as I said for investors. That whatever information is available, we tend to put more importance to information that confirms what we think. So yet again, if it's buying another company, maybe that company looks attractive because, their products are similar to our products, we're a good match. And we focus on that side of it, the attraction of it, and perhaps don't attach enough importance to how profitable it actually is. That all the information's there, but we say, I think it's a good mix with our company. Yes, those figures confirm it. And then we tend to attach less importance to other figures, which may be actually equally as important. So there we are. I hope I've given you the idea that in theory, take the information, there's the decision, no argument. In practice, though, people don't always make rational decisions, and there are the reasons. So there's no attempt to what you might call solve the problem. Although the more we're aware of the problem, perhaps the more we'll make sure we look at relevant information, the more perhaps we'll make sure we're objective and so on. Okay, well, as I said, that's the last one, for the moment anyway, of the pure discussion chapters. The next lecture we'll get straight on to the numbers proper.